Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to SBI Cards and Payment Services Limited Q2 FY22 earnings conference call. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Rama Mohan Rao Amara, Managing Director and Chief Executive Officer of SBI Card. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, Faizan. Good evening, everyone. I extend a very warm welcome to all of you. Thank you for your presence today at the SBI Card and Payment Services Limited earnings call for Q2 FY22. We truly appreciate your continued patronage and trust. I hope you and your loved ones are safe and healthy. It is heartening to see the pace of countrywide vaccination. India recently achieved a massive feat of administering 1 billion vaccines. As a result, majority of the population is now covered with at least one dose. With increased vaccinations and continuing COVID-related precautions, normalcy is gradually returning across businesses, and it is also boosting consumer sentiment. A recent report by IMF has indicated that India will be the fastest-growing major economy in the world, with its GDP growth expected to be at 9.5% in 2021 and 8.5% in 2022. This is in line with the RBI's target for growth projection for FY21-22 at 9.5%. Composite PMI for India sustained at above 55 level in August and September 2021. As per reports, both manufacturing and services sectors have shown steady recovery. While most parameters are positive, global supply chain continues to be strained and is likely to take some more time to normalize. Consumer sentiment too is up and is likely to spur consumer spending. As we have seen in the past, digitization of payments is increasing and is growing further. Consumer spending is moving towards the discretionary products and a gradual revival in travel is also visible. Continuing with progressive approach, regulators in recent months have introduced many initiatives to further make the digital payments safe for everyone. For instance, permitting card-on-file tokenization to enhance security and convenience, which is going to be effective from 1st of January 2022. Now I will present a business overview and the new initiatives. As an agile organization, we have taken all measures to pursue sustainable business growth during the quarter. The results are visible across our business. For instance, our new accounts witnessed a very strong growth during the quarter at well over 9.5 lakh new cards. In fact, addition of new accounts has been about 56% jump as compared to previous quarter. New account sourcing through SBI channel has nearly doubled compared to the previous quarter, with over 4 lakh new accounts added during Q2 FY22. Our cards in force are now well over at 12.5 million. As a result, we have been able to increase our market share in cards in force, maintaining our position as the second largest card issuer. Positive business momentum can also be gauged from growth witnessed in spends. At well over 43,000 crores during the quarter, SBI Card witnessed the highest ever spends during the quarter. There has been a sharp increase in both retail spends and corporate spends, with both witnessing a 41% and 80% year-on-year growth respectively. Noticeably, online spends continue to grow steadily across most categories. Importantly, and as expected, with gradual normalization of the situation on the ground, POS spends across most categories such as departmental stores, health, utilities, education, consumer durables, furnishing and hardware have surpassed pre-COVID levels, that is December 19 to February 20 levels, with apparel and jewelry registering the highest growth. Travel and entertainment related transactions too have finally witnessed impressive growth, though they are still to reach pre-COVID levels. During the period, we rolled out varied initiatives to keep our customers informed, inspired, and engaged. For instance, our campaign, Kushiyon Ka Credit Card. In line with an increased preference, we continued offering customers with easy payments, such as EMI at low interest rate levels, which have been received well. We initiated steps to further improve, strengthen, and diversify our portfolio. BPCL SBI Card got introduced on the RuPay network during the period. We are noticing continuous steady improvement in delinquencies. We have also successfully switched to new mechanism for recurring payments as per the deadline mandated by RBI. Not only on business, but we have also maintained a strong focus on our commitment to create value through ESG. We have funded second waste management facility to recycle plastic waste at Ecotech Pearl, Greater Noida. We continued our investments towards skill development, healthcare, dry ration support, etc. to underprivileged. Significant strides towards diversity and inclusion. With the launch of women alumni hiring program, inclusive hiring for people with disabilities. I would like to express my special gratitude to all my colleagues at SBI Card who rose to the challenges and diligently followed their professional responsibilities that have helped us to reach so far successfully. Let me now take you through our financial performance for Q2 FY22. Our business model is inherently strong with robust fundamentals, and based on strong business performance in the quarter, the company has delivered profit after tax of Rs. 345 crores at 67% year-on-year growth. Driven by growth in spends, receivables have grown by 12% year-on-year to close at 26,700 crores plus, further leading to a total income at 2,695 crores at 7% year-on-year. Our operating expenditure was higher by 25% year-on-year, driven by higher business volume. On asset quality, our GNPA has come down to 3.36% as compared to 3.91% at Q1 FY22. Net NPA for the period is at 0.91%. The overall management overlay to cover ourselves for future credit risk stands at 231 crores as on September 21. Despite addition of 105 crores towards RBI RE 2.0, the overall book has declined from 1,376 crores in Q1 to 1,030 crores in Q2. The share of RBI RE book stands at 4% of total receivables as against 6% in Q1. For the RBI RE book, which is between 30 days to 90 days, the company continues to provide its Stage 3 ECL rate of 64.9%. For the RBI RE book greater than 90 days, the company provides it 100%. Return on average assets for the quarter ended September 21 is at 4.9%, which is higher by 155 basis points as compared to 3.4% for Q1 FY22. And ROAE is at 20.1%, which is higher by 594 basis points as compared to 14.1% for Q1 FY22. On liquidity and capital adequacy, our liquidity position continues to be strong during Q2. Our capital adequacy ratio for the period ended September is at 25% as compared to 25.3% at Q2 FY21. In Q2 FY22, our Tier 1 ratio has improved to 21.8% from 21% at Q2 FY21. Our liquidity coverage ratio for the period ended September 21 is at 74% as against a statutory requirement of 50%. Our credit ratings remain excellent with the A1 plus and AAA ratings by CRISIL and ICRA for both short-term and long-term borrowings. These strong credit ratings by the rating agencies reflect our robust financials. While the future impact of COVID-19 on the company's results remain uncertain, I would like to reiterate that as of now, most of the business activities are back at pre-COVID levels, including sourcing of new accounts and spends on credit cards. During the COVID period, the company has exercised prudence to preserve economic value of the business. While we remain watchful of macro environment, we will continue to pursue all opportunities for sustainable business growth. With that, let's open the call for questions, Faizan. You may please open the call for questions.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. Reminder to the participants, anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one. Ladies and gentlemen, in order to ensure that the management is able to address questions from all participants in the conference, please limit your questions to two per participant. Should you have a follow-up question, we would request you to rejoin the question queue. The first question is from the line of Anuj Singla from Bank of America. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good evening, everyone, and thanks for the opportunity. So my first question is with regards to the disconnect between spends market share and card in force market share. So the presentation shows we have gained 30 basis points card in force. Transaction market share is also up 30 basis points, but we lost around 40 basis points on the spend market share. Seems to be indicating that spends per card for us is trailing the industry. Can you give some color on, is this related to corporate spends? Because what we, the data we get is for the total spends. Is that where we are losing some market share, or is the retail side as well? And the corollary to that question is, what are we doing something to address this?
Yeah, Anush. Yeah, with regard to your query on the market share disconnect between the cards in force and spends, you are right. To some extent, it is on account of corporate spends. While transaction share-wise, we have been maintaining a transaction share steadily improving, we feel like the competition, the perhaps third largest players, actually recorded better spends. We have seen, like, public information is also available in August. With their month-wise, when we look at their spends, crossed our spends, that's a fact. When we compared, while the clear-cut information is not available, the breakup is not available in terms of how much of their spends are on account of corporate, how much are on account of retail. The comparison of their trajectory in terms of transaction share versus the spends does indicate that transaction size has increased of late for ICICI. That's a clear indication that it's a play of corporate spends. We have adopted a consistent approach. We never wanted to take undue risk in terms of, the corporate exposure. Because we feel like with a low margin kind of corporate spends, it is always like we need to be mindful of the risk. Their risk appetite was perhaps, maybe different. We are evaluating the opportunities to ramp up while keeping an eye on the risk.
Okay, understood, sir. And the second question is with regards to, regarding the disconnect between spend growth and the receivable growth. So QOQ spends have risen like to all-time high, which you mentioned, 31% QOQ growth. But the receivable growth is only 9.4%. And within receivable, revolver in term is only 5.8% on QOQ, so as the transactors has increased. So one question is, is it something which we continue in the second half as well, where the spends tend to continue to do well given the festive season, and the receivable growth will remain muted? And the second part is, what is driving this significant rise in transactors? Is it seasonal? Is it something which is there in the economy? If you can provide some help there.
Hi Anush. So the way the cards, what happens is that, and I'm giving you the flow. When the customer spends on the card, at that point of time, either you get that some amount of spends on the EMI, which we call it as a subvention spends. Some we convert immediately into a closed-ended, which is what we call FlexiPay. So when you see the spend increase, along with that, the closed-ended loans also have been increasing. The new closed-ended loans have been increasing at a higher pace than the earlier ones. Okay. The second thing is that the transactors in the, for example, let's say whatever new spends are happening in the month of September, so that will come initially as a transactor spend, and over a period of time that starts getting converted into some, depending on the kind of portfolio, spending patterns, repayment patterns, it gets converted into revolvers. And you are right, it is to a degree the asset built up follows the spends on the card, because unless until there is spend and transactions, the asset buildup will not happen. Okay, that is point one. Second thing is the rates are not exactly the same. You will never have, if there is a growth of 100% on spends, then 100% of asset will increase. That is also not there, because there are old assets gets, some of that gets repaid, new assets get built. The percentage is vary depending on the profile mix and the consumer behavior mix, which is happening at that point of time. But we are hoping that, that in the Q2, because of strong spends which have come up, that will build up into asset in Q3. And Q3 is hopefully, as of now, we are seeing very strong. And if there is no COVID overhang, we should be able, that it should give further boost to spends, which again, because that's the input to building
Thank you. Mr. Singla, may we request that you return to the question queue for follow-up questions. Thank you. The next question is from the line of Amit Nanavati from Nomura. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. I have a question on revolvers, right? Basically, you've seen, at least at a macro level, you've seen higher attrition and pay hikes for the IT and banking industry in general, right? So salary levels are going up and going up nicely. Does this historically you would have seen, but just if you can give some sense, does this increase the propensity to kind of leverage through cards, or generally the needs to evolve goes down in the transitory period when your salaries are rising and your spends kind of catch up over time?
Can you just repeat the question? I think the line was not clear.
Am I audible now?
Yeah, better.
Yeah. So basically, you've seen, the largest salary segment, right? In from an industry perspective, would be IT and banking. Here, you've seen higher attrition, higher pay hikes across the board. Does this historically, you would have had some sense? Does this increase the propensity to leverage through credit cards, or does it kind of for the transitory period reduce the need to kind of revolve, which means your revolver book takes much longer time to kind of build up? The spends may go up, but the revolve book may not go up in tandem.
No, we have not seen that. Okay. And in fact, in last earlier multiple calls, we have reiterated this. What we see here is, today when the customer is spending, he has multiple choices to convert into a closed-ended term loan balance. Okay, so easily he can convert at the point of sale itself. The interest rates are very low, very competitive, 14%. If he wants to do it at a later date before the payment due date, anywhere between 14 to 22%. The interest rates are available. So revolving is more from a short-term funding perspective that the customer uses. If he thinks funds coming back to him in next 1 or 2 months, people will pay revolve in that sense. Okay? Now, given that is the thing, scenario, after COVID and after RE, we had shifted almost 9% of our asset into RE. All that 9% was revolving at one point of time. So now the new cycle has to start after this. So the new cycle is what we see has already started. This new cycle is first you're getting new customers. That is already upwards of 9.5 lakhs for this quarter. That those customers are spending. We are already seeing that spend behavior coming back. Average spends are higher than pre-COVID level. Now the last step here is that building asset on these set of customers. Even on these customers, the closed-ended asset, the term asset is already being, we are already able to see that. It is a revolving balances, which we will have to see as to how it comes out. We have been tighter in our underwriting criteria in the last 1.5 years. So maybe it will not go back to the original numbers, but there is still an increase that we foresee in the coming months.
Understood. And secondly, if I look at the cost to income ratio, right, you are back because the acquisitions are back, the spends are back, so we are back to that 56-57% kind of cost to income ratios. For the transitory period till such time that the revolver book builds up, right, but your acquisitions are back, the spends are back, do you see this cost to income ratio now from these levels, at least in the near term, next 1-2 quarters, going further up, or is this where it kind of peaks out?
So, Amit, you're right that because what had happened, and if you look at the business in the last few quarters, and we've mentioned this in the past as well, that this was not a pause but a reset. It wasn't that due to COVID, customers stopped spending and the COVID got over, the second wave got over, customers started spending. It's a reset because the profile of the customer, etc., changed. what we've done from our side is that as this reset happened, we had to reinvest into the business. We've got started sourcing aggressively, and that's what you've seen, the Q1 to Q2, the movement in the new accounts. So that requires investment. That's what we've done. The growth in spend, both in corporate and retail, that too requires investment. The market is competitive, so one has to invest in the market to encourage and entice customers to spend. And now this is a cycle that has started. The investment has been done. The spends have come. What it would do is that this is the festival season, say, even in Q3. We would definitely need some more investment, and we would like to do that. Cost to income is something we're very, very particular, and we would like to bring it back, but may not happen in the immediate one or two quarters, because this is the time to build the business back. And once we've got the right amount of asset and the right amount of interest-bearing asset, you'll find that our cost to income will get will start coming down. But this is something that we're very focused on. It's just that the phase of the business requires that at this point of time, investment is required. And then the normal, you know, economies of scale will kick in.
Thank you, Mr. Nanavati. May we request that you return to the question queue for follow-up questions? Thank you. The next question is from the line of Nitin Agarwal from Motilal Oswal Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for the opportunity. So two questions. One is, like, if I look at the sourcing from under 30 years, this has increased to 41% during the quarter versus 24% at the outstanding level. So if you can share some color as to how the spend share of this type of customers, like the age-wise, this proportion of customers, how much contribution do they make in total spends? And therefore, what implications will it have on our overall spend growth and spend per card?
So, as you have seen on the overall basis, that the spend per card is now on a higher level and all, actually higher than pre-COVID, if we look at it, and especially retail spends per card. The reason why we go for more younger customers is that so that we are there longer with them in their lifetime. So the earlier you get them at the stage of, let's say, 22, 23, as they have started their jobs and they are starting to get their salaries, the moment you start with them with a product, which is, let's say, a 500 rupee product, even if they are in tier 2, tier 3 cities, over a period of time, as they stay longer with you, their incomes will rise, and we have seen that happening with us. Customers have been with us for almost 15-20 years, and over a period of time, we will upgrade them. So the income stream from these customers is not to be looked at from a more lifetime perspective, and this is what we have seen, that these customers stick with us.
Right, but fair to say that over the next couple of years, till the time you are able to upgrade, the spend per card and overall spending can come down, and we may lose spend market share.
No. So, see, spend per card and market share are two different things. As our MD sir was saying, that the market share is because of retail and corporate or B2B spends mix, and their top line play at low margin is more B2B spends. On the retail spend side of it, these customers are actually quite good, because younger customers are doing more online spending, and we are, as you can see already, online spend share is upwards of 53, is between 53-54% of the total spending, and they are more savvier. They do their transactions online, they also service themselves online, the cost comes down over a period of time, so it is a on an overall basis, we believe that they are the right TG. In fact, our target TG has always been anywhere between 27 to 35.
Okay, awesome. And so the other question is, like, the margins have come down sharply over the quarter, mainly understand with the decline in revolver mix, and this is impacting our interest income. But now also the cost of funds has shown an increase. So what is the, like, outlook on margins around, like, over the next couple of years?
Yeah, you are correct. NIM has definitely recorded slight decline. It is also a function of the composition, where the transactor balances now account for 37%. As the revolver starts, Girish also said, like, a transactor balances will take some time to get converted into revolver. As we see some pickup in revolver, definitely the yields will improve. Of course, to maximize the income, we were focusing on, in fact, the flows are what we call closed NEA or otherwise the EMI-based kind of loans. We were focusing on ramping up the FlexiPay, otherwise NCash, etc., and including subvention. We were able to keep pace with the growth in NEA in terms of them. That's the reason the shares continued at 32%. But having said that, these are the kind of investment what we need to make, and that so it will take time to improve the NIM. But NIM is only one part. I mean, interest income is only like 45 to 46% of our overall revenue. We have the other major contributor by way of fee income and other income. So there we were able to get good growth quarter on quarter. With that, we were able to absorb the elevated expenses, particularly the OPEX. 25% increase was there quarter on quarter. That we were able to absorb that, and then still able to maintain earnings before credit cost in absolute terms. I'm not talking about as a percentage, but in absolute terms, we were able to maintain the EBCC. This is the kind of investment what we are making now, which will give the results in the subsequent quarter.
So, on the cost of funds side, this is more of a play of averages. What we are seeing is our daily cost of fund is more or less the same, and we think that we should be able to maintain this in the coming quarter as well. As sir said, it's more of a, as the transactors start getting converted into revolver, the yield would go up, and therefore that's what play on the NIM side will come more from the yield rather than from cost of fund. Cost of fund would more or less be, static.
Sure. Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Subramanian Iyer from Morgan Stanley. Please go ahead.
Hi, thanks for the opportunity. I have a question on ad quality. So if I just run some competitions, what I see is that the net slippages for the quarter were roughly about 585 to 600 crores. And so it is broadly flattened quarter on quarter. So how should we think about this going forward? While COVID problems is obviously an uncertain thing, but other things remaining the same, would you expect this number to come off pretty sharply and normalize?
If we were to look at our overall GNPAs, they have been sequentially declining quarter on quarter. So we were 4.99, we came down to 3.91. This quarter we are down to 3.36. And as you would notice, a lot of our stress book is getting written off and running off. So we, as more and more of the stress book goes out, we should see this on an improving trend. So you're right, this should improve over, everything else remaining unchanged. We should expect this trend to continue.
Okay. In the reason I was focusing on next decision because the NPA going down is also a function of write-offs. Point taken that you expect to improve. The other question was on we should think about the jaws between income growth and cost growth the medium term over the next 2 to 3 years. Do you expect to see a bit of non-linearity in costs and income growth over medium term, or as you said that you need to keep investing for some time?
So when you look at the income growth, as sir had mentioned, the interest bearing asset, especially the revolver side, was on the lower side, we got the income from the fee and services. As we see higher spends continuing, the trend on spends continue, we'll continue to get that income. It's just that the transactor conversion into interest bearing asset, whether into an EMI or the revolver, that would change the game. In the near term, I would say that cost to income could remain elevated because we would like to pump in a little bit more money into the market. One is the competitive scenario. Second is it's the rebuilding of the business because 1.5 years you've seen that the spends were moving. It was not a clear line of growth. It was coming up, but because of some disruption or the other, would come down. This is the first time we are seeing that in the last 4 or 5 months, especially from June onwards, there is a trajectory of growth. So this is the time to invest into the business. The jaws on income and expense at this point of time, I would say that from the business side, we look at it time to invest. So even if the cost to income remains slightly elevated, that's fine. The moment these customer spend starts converting into asset and asset into interest-bearing asset, you'll find that the cost to income and the you know, the operating leverage, everything will start moving in a different direction. So that's how the business will work, and that's how we are looking at it, and that's how we are working towards and investing into the business.
Thank you, Mr. Iyer. May we request that you return to the question queue for follow-up questions. Thank you. The next question is from the line of Dhaval Gada from DSP Investment Managers. Please go ahead.
Hi. Thanks for the opportunity. I had two questions. First is just on the revolve rate. I just wanted to sort of clarify, you know, how when do you see, you know, the company return to about 38% to 40% revolve rate, which we had seen pre-COVID. In your experience in the past, like how many quarters does it take to build up that kind of level from current 27% odd level? And the second question was around, you know, you've been working with some of these fintech companies on you know, the small ticket product, unsecured product. I just wanted to understand, would you be able to give some size around your pay later business with these companies in terms of number of customers or the monthly volumes that you do with these partners today? Yeah, those are the two questions. Thanks.
I think with regard to your query on the revolver, I think previous last year when we compare the asset composition vis-à-vis the last year's corresponding time, I think it is at the elevated level of 34-35%, mostly on account of the moratorium, which actually, like, where no repayment was envisaged or no repayment was demanded, unless and until voluntarily it was paid by the cardholder. That definitely resulted. Ideally, also, we would like to have a one-third. Like, that is a typically a kind of stable state kind of composition. But as we responded earlier to one of the queries, the last 1.5 years, we have tightened the risk filters in order to tackle the asset quality. Automatically, that brings in a kind of less risky customers who may have lesser propensity to revolve also. And now we are seeing like asset quality is improving steadily. So we are recalibrating our approach in a gradual way. So obviously that will also permit slightly a new segment of customers who can add to the revolver. So this is a journey. I mean, very difficult to envisage whether it is whether we are going to come back to normal composition in 2 quarters, 3 quarters. But we will never lose any opportunity to maximize the revenue. In fact, that is what we said earlier. Like if a customer may not have a propensity to revolve, but then we will be offering a very, EMI kind of loans at competitive rates in order to maximize the revenue. Other part of fintech, can you respond?
So we have no specific tie-ups as of now with any fintech on giving small ticket because we are doing credit cards only. Only thing that we do here is that all our customers are able to, when they are making a transaction, we have tied up with a lot of partners so that they can convert their spends into a pay later of 3 months or 6 months or 9 months while purchasing the goods itself, and especially on the online. So we all these facilities are available on Amazon, Flipkart, Paytm, almost all large top players. But he has to have a SBI credit card to avail that facility. And we see very large volumes there. We have not declared the number, but the volumes are very large in our customers itself who are utilizing this facility.
And that would be part of our EMI book, is it correct?
It's part of our term loan book, yes.
Term loan, okay. And just one data question, what is the size of the EPP book now and any provision that we carry on that portfolio?
EPP should be very small.
EPP is insignificant, and it's in the normal course of business. We don't even call it out. That was there in the first RBI RE. At that time, we were looking at converting the customers into EPP. Now, it is not something that is happening. It's a very small thing. And just technical point, you said revolve rate and revolver. I'll just clarify. What you see in the asset is revolver. Revolve rate is revolver over revolver asset over revolver asset plus the transactor. So our revolve rate is around about 43%. Revolver are 27% of the asset. Just a technical point. Your question was still relevant.
Yeah, thanks. Thank you. All the best.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Saurav from JP Morgan. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi sir. Sir, two questions. One is, you know, what percentage of your spends are travel, and how much is it down?
Sorry, not clear from your line, sir. Please check.
Your question was how much percentage of your spends is on travel. Was that the question?
Yeah. Sir, on page 10, the last category, what percentage of the spends are from travel, that segment, and how much is it down, you know, versus pre-COVID levels?
So, travel, typically, on a pre-COVID, because I'm taking the whole category, travel,
yeah.
Travel agents, airline, and that, because there used to be a variation on a monthly basis, but would fall anywhere between early double digits. Okay, so it used to be that. At this point of time, as we have put in our investor presentations, it is lower than pre-COVID number. Travel entertainment is actually the only category which is lower than pre-COVID. Rest everything has gone up, and the best part is that the point of sale also has gone up versus pre-COVID. So, this travel and entertainment as a category is still down, primarily because overseas travel is still not opened up and international travel has to go up. Domestic travel we see is almost close to normal.
Yeah, sir. And how much is it down versus pre-COVID? I mean, can you quantify that percentage?
Okay, so it would be around 2/3 to 70% of the pre-COVID number.
Okay, got it. The second, sir, is on this pay later thing. So, you know, some of the other private banks have launched a separate pay later option, you know, for their customers. Will it be a fair understanding that if SBI would launch the pay later option, that should rest within SBI card? I mean, it will flow through SBI cards, or that can happen separately as well?
We cannot comment, or we don't know what's the strategy of SBI in terms of BNPL. But as far as we are concerned, like a credit card, you are already aware, it is always like a BNPL plus. So, but the space is interesting. Definitely, a lot of buzz is there, a lot of activities happening, number of players or new players are entering the space. We are watching it closely, and as a segment, we feel like it's a different segment, slightly different from a matured credit card customer base. But it is like expanding the market. So
okay.
It is like mostly it is new to the credit kind of segment of customers, a very, very thin file in bureau, that kind of segment. Once they evolve, then they can become like a credit eligible for the credit card, giving credit cards also. So we see it as a kind of opportunity. They're just observing, but we don't know much about
SBA's
plan.
Okay, and one last question with your permission, sir. Basically, you know, on your credit losses, given we have almost gone through 18 months of COVID, and I'm assuming your underwriting filters were tightened through these 18 months, will it be fair to assume that as your, you know, this restructured book rolls down and we've come out of COVID, a forward credit cost should actually be lower than normalized levels of this 7% or?
I mean, we have always maintained that actually the trajectory of the credit cost will be correlated to the trend of RBRE. So that's a reasonable assumption that as the RBRE share comes down further, you can expect corresponding kind of improvement to happen, definitely.
Thank you, Mr. Saurabh. May we request that you return to the question queue for follow-up questions. Thank you. The next question is from the line of Antariksha Banerjee from ICICI Prudential AMC. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hello. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah. Thanks. So first set of questions is actually for Aparna ma'am and Girish sir both. So I know Revolver has been discussed a fair bit. I just wanted to understand from a structural perspective as we come out of COVID and in the medium term, right, and compare that to what it used to be pre-COVID. So during this period, your sourcing has predominantly been more safe. And if I look at this quarter chart, it's more from, it's less from category B salaried customers. It's much more from tier two. You're sourcing more from SBI. Do all those have an implication on where the revolve rates or the revolver rate rather will stabilize after COVID on a steady state basis? And what's the roadmap from getting from this 27 to the one third of the 33 that you aspire to be? And also, is the category of spends an influencer in whether the transactions are converted to EMI or eventually revolve? In the sense that the travel is the only one which is lagging. Is that also correlated with the fact that revolve balances are not picking up?
Okay, so two parts to your question. I'll try and answer the first part, actually the second part. So, yes, there are certain categories which are more amenable to converting into the EMI products. And these categories would be consumer durables, specifically purchase of smartphones. This category would be large ticket size furnishings. This category would be travel, obviously, has international travel used to be in one of those categories where people who do it for leisure would convert into and pay into installments. So there are certain categories which are more amenable to this kind of for EMI thing. There are, however, what I would say is there are two tailwinds to this. The first is that as the overall spending increases, and the customer spends more, there is a propensity to convert that into installment payments. The second is there are a lot of these categories, especially in tier 2, are now opening up majorly. So smartphone penetration is going up, people changing smartphones every year. So a whole lot of that consumer behavior and their put it as that their propensity to be comfortable with installment lending products is far, far higher. So that consumer behavior change is very helpful in that sense. On the revolve piece, as our MD sir was also saying that yes, in last 1.5 years, we have been more careful in terms of our choice of customers. So the revolve rates will not be as high as what we used to see in a pre-COVID level. But there is definitely an increase possible from the present levels. Aparna?
Thank you. Mr. Banerjee, may we request that you return to the question queue for follow-up questions. The next question is from the line of Abhijit Sakhare from Kotak Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, good evening. First question is on the tokenized payment product. Just wanted to broadly understand what's been the user adoption of this particular product. Specifically, customers using SBI cards at an offline location and paying through a QR code specifically. So at the back end, it gets paid out using SBI cards, but the front end is essentially some sort of a QR code out there.
Yeah. So your tokenization is, while I'll come to tokenization, but the simple one is, the three trends. First is point of sale is growing and it's come back to pre-COVID. The second point which you mentioned was around so Tap and Go is now more than one out of four transactions on the POS is Tap and Pay. With RBI increasing it to 5,000, that has helped quite a lot. People don't want to touch things and the tap thing is working out quite nicely. On the Google Pay and Samsung Pay and wherever we have done the tokenization, so every month we see a higher increase in the customer adoption in terms of numbers. But the numbers are still not very high. It's still early stages. It is now getting in. So So while we can put in, send you the numbers later on exactly what it is, but the numbers are at very early stages on this one.
Sure. Second one is on the reward points. What's the general utilization of reward points that you've seen over the years? And the question is in the context of why don't we go into full cash back and offer some sort of an instant gratification? And related to that, do we at the back end, do we have the ability to personalize redemption as per the customer's patterns or behavior that we've seen over the years?
Okay. We do cash back, which is instant cash back at with online pay. So presently there is a one which is running with Flipkart. You can go there and use your SBI card to get a 10% cash back. That runs at multiple places. Online it is easier because instantly it is possible. We also do cashback offers which customers get later after they have spent. Why can't we get away from rewards fully? Because rewards is given to the customers for all the spends. Cashback is not necessarily given on all the spends. The last part is about what people redeem on cashback. So we have close to 300 to 400 product offerings and vouchers, and customers can also convert into cash directly onto their credit statement. Direct credit to statement is preferred, but it is but majority of the customers still like to have e-vouchers and pots and pans because that they can gift to others or do various things with it. And yes, we have the capacity to not only personalize this on an individual customer level, but we, on the basis that we run programs also, but we also try to change behavior because direct credit into the statement is, from a redemption perspective, is more expensive to us compared to when the customer takes a voucher or pots and pan where we enjoy some discounts. So we work at changing the consumer behavior also in the long term.
Got it. This is helpful. Just one data on the write-offs for the quarter. That will be all. Thank you.
It's 647.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you can work it out. Give it the number. For how much is the number?
647. It's the
write-off
of the 670 odd.
Thank you. So, Sakra, may we request you that we return to the question queue for follow-up questions. Thank you. The next question is from the line of Bhavik Dave from Nippon India Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Good evening, everyone. Just a few questions. One is, I see the subscription-based revenue line item being a little soft. Any color on what is happening around there? Question two is on the investment that we're doing. Are we doing anything to improve our value proposition in the sense that maybe come up with a digital card or make our app more funky with having the card linked on the app and make it more like a wallet and maybe easier to spend online using our card or QR, scanning the QR codes? And lastly, on the provisioning bit, what would be the outstanding provisioning on the restructured book? And just a clarification, the 200 odd crores that is 90 overdue in the restructured book is already a part of the 900 odd crores or 3.4% GNPA that we have, right?
Yes. So I think just a correction on the earlier one, I mentioned the gross write-off is 670. This should be about 640 odd. That's the right number. Now, in terms of provisioning on the restructured book, like we mentioned earlier, for the restructured book, anything that is between 30 to 90 days, we provide at about 65%, which is a normal NPA provision rate. And any NPA on the restructured book, we provide at 100%, and that remains unchanged. And yes, the RBI RE NPA is part of this 3.36 NPA that is given out.
Correct. And anything on the 600 odd crores, which is non 30 day overdue, obviously not the remaining part of the 1,000 odd crores, does that have any provision, or does that have that 230 odd crores of management overlay provision? Is that against that?
Like I mentioned, for RBI RE, anything that is not delinquent, we provide at the rate specified by RBI, which is 10%. Okay, that's the mandated provision rate. 30 to 90 is provided at 65, and greater than 90 is provided at 100.
Perfect. Well understood. That's perfectly understood. And the other two questions, one is subscription based fee, and second is on the improving the customer feel on the app or maybe a digital card to get the experience better for the customer on the card.
Subscription based fee.
You want to know the amount?
We know the amount, but I'm saying that the momentum on that, like pre-COVID and what it is today, the momentum of that spend growth of subscription fee has come off a bit. So just want to understand, are we getting more cards with lower end, or is the momentum for the free card a little higher? What is happening on the subscription fee base? That's one. And second is on the digital card or the app being a little more friendly and making it QR friendly or maybe like a wallet so that the customer uses that more often. That is what the understanding.
Subscription-based fee is comprises of two things. One is the membership fee which we charge, which will be basically to the new sets of customers that we've acquired, and it will also have the renewal fee, which will be on the base. So renewal fee will be a larger number compared to the membership fee, because membership fee only comes on the new accounts. Now, membership fee depends on the number of accounts that you're sourcing in a particular month or a quarter, and generally if you source in, say, in 1 month, month one, then the membership fee starts coming from the second month onwards, because by the time you build the customer, etc., it takes a month or so for it to start reflecting into the accounts. The other thing is that it gets deferred over a period of 12 months. So all the changes that you see are gradual in this. One is how you're picking up the sourcing. Second is, it's getting deferred over a period of 12 months. So the rise in that you see is gradual. As far as the fee is concerned, there is no, I would say that our sourcing of account has increased, so the fee will show a gradual increase, and also the premium portion of the total sourcing has also increased, so that too will help the uptick in the fee. But then, like I said, since it gets deferred over a period of 12 months, you don't see a drastic change in a particular period.
Thank you, Mr. Dave. May we request that you
return? Yes, you're right. We are working on our mobile app, but we are looking at it more from a hyper-personalization perspective with respect to each customer, given that our number of customers is fairly large and people's requirements are different. Some people want it to be funkier, more wallet-like, but some people want it to be quite safe and have more security parameters built into it. So depending on how the consumer behavior is, we're wanting to look at the UI UX of the customers. As far as the QR code and other things are concerned, the Bharat QR thing is already available on the app. Whatever is from a payment perspective is available on the networks, which is either Visa, MasterCard, RuPay or Amex. We make that available on our mobile app. Be it the QR code, be it the tokenization, so we've been working on that to give almost all the 100% of our servicing onto mobile app. So today a customer actually doesn't need to get in touch with us unless until he's wanting to report a lost and stolen, that too that he can do on the app. But for most of the services, the customer can actually use the mobile app to service themselves. But you're right, it requires, we'll have to continuously update it, and we are working towards the same objective.
Thank you. Mr. Dave, may we request that you return to the question queue for follow-up questions. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, please limit your questions to one per participant. Should you have a follow-up question, we would request you to rejoin the question queue. The next question is from the line of Rohan Mandora from Equirus. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi sir. Thanks for the opportunity. So wanted to mention two things. One was, in terms of the employee cost, we are seeing a decline both Q1 and year on year. So just want to understand, is there a reduction on employees or what is driving the reduction in employee costs? And second, on the liability side, the borrowing from CPs has been coming down. So earlier we had indicated from an ALM perspective, the CP composition fits into the scheme of things. But is there a change in strategy there in terms of the borrowing mix?
I didn't get the second.
So
first, let me answer about the salary employee cost. Now, a couple of things. It has the cost of ESOP also. So a bit of accounting-related thing as to how much charge has come, and nothing as such that we've reduced the number of employees, etc. It is more the average headcount as a marginal change. So it's more of an accounting-related this thing rather than anything else. So no reduction in headcount, etc. Yes, we haven't really increased the headcount. It's more or less stagnant at that level. So it's more to do with that. Sorry, I didn't get the second part of the question. If you can repeat that.
Saying the borrowing mix, if you look at the commercial paper, CP borrowing is at 6% in Q2 FY22. And if you look at the earlier part of FY21, it was around  15%-20%. So from the ALM perspective, as you had indicated earlier, the CP does make sense because most of our assets are short-term. So is there a change in strategy wherein we will have a lower CP incrementally because that would have probably some impact on them?
Yeah. So let me answer this. One is when you say that our assets are on the lower side, so one should borrow short-term. No, no. It's not really like that. There is a core asset which is always there, so you need to borrow at different intervals as well. So that's the first thing. CP, again, depends on how much we borrow largely on the working capital limits. So we have a large working capital limits. And working capital limits, what happens is if you look at it the last few quarters, our asset buildup was not so much. And that was mainly because of the COVID-related this thing. And while we had higher working capital limits. So to avail of CP facilities, you need to be utilizing your working capital limits to a certain specific percentage. If your utilization is lower than that, then the CP is not available. What we did was, in the previous quarters, it was our working capital utilization was lower. We did not go to the CP market. We relied mainly on the consortium borrowing. But that too was coming more for us at the similar rate what we were getting from the CP. So from a rate perspective, we were not in any way got impacted. The instrument-wise, yes, we changed. Instead of a CP, we took WCDL, etc. But our WCDL, etc. also hovered around a similar rate as the CP. So from a rate perspective, it did not impact us. But the instrument was different.
Thank you. We'll take the next question from the line of Karthik Chellappa from Buena Vista Fund Management. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Thank you for the opportunity. So if we look at the 30-day activity ratio, close to 50%, it's still about 4%-5% below the pre-COVID levels. So over what period of time do you expect to reach that ratio? And related to that, if I look at the other operating expenses of about 1,200 crores, how much of that would be variable and linked directly to customer acquisition? Thank you.
On the first part of your question, because a lot of those active customers were put into RE and blocked for future customer spending at that stage. So that is why you saw the number coming down. What we already see is that on a like-to-like basis, we would already be anywhere between 52%-55%, and this number is continuously going up. So as you can see, already with taking all those cards into consideration also, as I was mentioning in the last quarter's update also, that it's now 50. So this is the average of each month. So this is July, August, September. It is an average of all those 3 months. It's running at 50%. And what we have seen is that in the season months, it's going further up. So this is on a continuous increase. Some of the segments, for example, tier one or so, we already see that they have already reached. Actually, some of them are higher than the pre-COVID levels also.
Got it, sir. And on the other operating expenses, sir, how much of that would be directly linked to customer acquisition?
But we don't give that breakup, but customer acquisition cost for a card business is a substantial investment that you do. Two big lines of cost which are there, which one is the spend-based cost, which comprises of cashback, passback, reward related, and the other one is the acquisition cost. We don't give the breakup, but I can tell you both of these costs constitute a major portion of the operating expenses.
Thank you. We'll take the next question from the line of Param Subramanian from Macquarie. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. I wanted to ask on something you mentioned, which was that the POS-based checkout financing, you're seeing good trends there, and this is part of, you know, a larger trend that we are seeing across the industry. So, do you see this eating away from the share of the percentage of revolver in your receivable mix going forward, since, you know, this is a convenient mode of payment? And could this affect our, you know, targets of ramping back the 27% revolvers back to 33-34%? That's question one. And secondly, I also wanted to ask, you know, on the revolver portion, you know, a lot of the BNPL fintech players, their value proposition is, you know, largely targeted towards, you know, the kind of customers who revolve with their credit cards. So does that affect your revolver percentage? Those are my questions.
On the first part, these options have been available since a long period of time, but consumer behaviors can change because this growth in, as you said, the checkout-based conversion into a term product or a loan product is there. One thing is to be noted is that on a credit card, the average credit limits are fairly high. Whereas some of these players, they give the limit. Now they have started experimenting with larger limits, but it's still not that high because the average limit on a credit card is upwards of 80,000 to 100,000. So in those segments, and once the customer has a card, it is the easiest option for him because it's at the point of checkout, it's single click, you don't have to fill any document, you don't have to give any name, you don't have to do anything. So anybody who has a credit card is actually will use a credit card, and we are seeing that. So the game plan or strategy for us has to be that as these customers take these loans and build their credit history, we are able to give cards to them on a continuous basis and grow our portfolio so that they come to use the product which is more easier, gives them rewards, gives them cash back, can be used internationally, and also is be able to give them the benefit of the pay later option which is available.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we will take the last question from the line of Roshan Chutke from ICICI Prudential Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for taking my question. Firstly, just want to understand, shouldn't the instant-based fee go up when revolver proportion is increasing and vice versa? That's question one I have. And the second question is, in the ALM table for the 1 to 3 year bucket, last two quarters we have seen an inflow increasing there almost by 250 crores last quarter and again this quarter from another 100 odd crores. What is happening? Why is the inflow in the 1 to 3 year bucket increasing? That's second question number two. If you can answer these and then I'll come back later.
So instance-based fee comprises of a couple of things, not just the late fees. It also has over-limit fees. It also has check bouncing, check dishonor, auto-debit failure, etc. So while you're right that if there is an impact on the revolver side, the late fees would get impacted, but sometimes it does get compensated by over-limit fees, etc. as well. So it's a play depending on which side is up, but yes, in the normal course, late fees and revolver side would go hand in hand because late fees and revolver comes like that. So that's one. Second question, Roshan, you'll have to repeat. I couldn't really catch. There was some
ALM 1 to 3 years.
Airline 1 to 3 years has seen inflow last two quarters, consecutive quarters, substantial inflow. So what is happening there?
So in ALM 1 to 3 year inflow side, you have the EMI portion of our asset, which is there. So as we are increasing, if you look at it, even though our EMI percentage has remained at 32% quarter to quarter, but that 32% has been maintained on a increased asset base. So and also the kind of EMIs that we do. There is short-term EMIs relating to subvention FlexiPay. Then there is a long-term one on the in-cash side, which is greater than 1 year and goes up to three and a half years. So that one is also rising, and that's what impacts the inflows into 1 to 3 years.
And how should I think about the stage two assets number, the 11% odd number? How much of that is typically, what is the experience? How much of it flows forward?
Sorry, can you repeat?
The stage 2 assets number, which is about 12%, slightly less than 12%, how does it, I mean, how is the behavior generally? How much of it flows forward?
I don't think we really, we've not given that flow rate out in how much of stage 2 goes into stage 3. However, I think on a broad basis, I can tell you that we've seen an improvement in the absolute stage 2 itself quarter on quarter. I think like we mentioned earlier, as some of our stress pool gets out, the fact that our stage 3 assets are in general coming down is on account of two things. One, of course, is that the stress pool is getting out, getting written off, but incrementally, whatever we've been booking in the last one and a half years, we have significantly tightened our credit criteria. So the quality of the book of the last 18 months is actually quite good. So overall, we are finding that slippages in from 1 to 2 as well as 2 to 3 are showing an improving trend.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, that was the last question. I would now like to hand the conference over to Mr. Rao, MD and CEO of SBI Card, for closing comments. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Yes, thank you, Faizan. So with markets steadily reaching the pre-COVID levels, increase in consumer confidence shows that Indian economy is on the recovery path. So higher consumption trends visible in the ongoing festive season also indicate the same. We will continue to follow healthy financial and corporate governance principles, which form our core strength. Before I conclude, let me wish all of you a very happy festive season. Thank you. Enjoy the festivities and stay safe. Thank you all.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of SBI Cards and Payment Services Limited, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect.